Good morning, students. Here we come up with the gross anatomy of the front of the forearm. So, in the front of the forearm, today we are going to discuss superficial muscles as well as the deep muscles. Superficial and deep muscles. There will be total 5 superficial muscles and 3 deep muscles of the front of forearm, which are very important. It's basically very simple. We first try and draw the line diagram. Please draw alongside with me, and then we are going to understand each and every muscle. So the line diagram, if we can accommodate within this the entire front of the forearm, lower end of humerus, which is very important. So here we are going to draw, or I will come more medially on this side, lower end of the humerus, and here we shall show this as coronoid, the capitulum. This is the capitulum. Then here we have to show this as trochlea. And here we are going to show the medial epicondyle. So in this way, this will be the medial epicondyle, this will be the lateral epicondyle, and capitulum and trochlea, very simple. So therefore, this will be radial fossa, this will be the coronoid fossa, and posteriorly olecranon fossa. Now lower down, we draw the head of the radius. Now after drawing the head of the radius, we start with the neck of the radius, radial tuberosity, and then over here we shall try and minimize it. The length we have to minimize because we want to accommodate here the metacarpals and phalanges also. So along with that, we try and draw the ulna, and here as we draw the ulna, lower end of the radius is lower than the ulna. Then at this point we are going to show very simple rough diagram. Now here we are going to show the scaphoid lunate triquetral pisiform, the proximal row of carpal bone, and then the distal row of carpal bones, trapezium, trapezoid, capitate and hemate. That is what we are going to show. And here hook of hemate. This is pisiform, this is hook of hemate. And then we try and show, these are the, here we are going to show metacarpals. So we can show the metacarpals. One, two, three, then four, five. In this way we show, we try and show it, whatever limited space we are having. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 metacarpals, then the phalanges. Now here we start with the superficial group of muscles. The superficial group of muscles will be, they are number 1, pronator teres. So pronator teres, the origin of pronator teres, and remember each and every muscle we are going to discuss as origin, insertion, action and nerve supply. So in pronator teres, the origin of pronator teres will be from two parts. That is, one part will be humeral, another part will be ulnar. So the humeral head of pronator teres will take its origin from the lower part of the medial supracondylar ridge of the humerus, number 1. This is the first origin of the pronator teres, the lower part of the medial supracondylar ridge of the humerus, as well as from the medial epicondyle of the humerus, as well as from the medial epicondyle of the humerus. Remember one thing, the medial epicondyle of humerus will serve as a common source of origin for all the flexor group of muscles of the front arm. So front of the forearm. So in the front of the forearm, whatever flexor group of muscles are there, they will take common origin from the anterior surface of medial epicondyle of the humerus. So our pronator teres, there will be two points of origin. Number 1, humeral. Number 2, ulnar. Now in humeral, once again the pronator teres will take its origin from two parts. Number 1, there will be the origin of pronator teres from the lower part of medial supracondylar ridge of the humerus, where I have marked. And second will be from the medial epicondyle. So from medial epicondyle also, this is the points of origin, humeral point of origin of pronator teres, and the ulnar point of origin of pronator teres will be from here, what we have shown, this portion, this is the coronoid process of the ulna. So from the medial margin of coronoid process of ulna, but distal to the origin of flexor digitorum superficialis. So here I will keep the origin of pronator teres. From the medial margin of the coronoid process of ulna, this is the coronoid process of the ulna, distal to origin of flexor. So somewhere over here there will be origin of flexor digitorum superficialis. Flexor digitorum superficialis. So this is the pronator teres, medial margin of coronoid process of ulna, distal to origin of flexor digitorum superficialis. Now the origin of pronator teres is complete. One, humeral origin from the lower part of medial supracondylar ridge of the humerus. Number two, from the anterior surface of the medial epicondyle of the humerus. And number three, from the medial margin of coronoid process of ulna, distal to the origin of flexor digitorum superficialis. And then insertion will be, now here if we draw this, the insertion will be like this. The insertion of this muscle will be on the lateral surface of the middle one third of radius. Lateral surface of middle one third of the radius. This is the insertion of pronator teres. So this is the first muscle. Now here you can draw this. This is the first muscle of the superficial part of the front of the forearm, pronator teres. Insertion into the lateral surface of the middle one third of radius. Now, nerve supply of pronator teres will be from median nerve. Nerve supply from median nerve, and the action of pronator teres will be pronator of the forearm as well as a very weak flexure of the elbow joint. Very weak flexure of the elbow joint. Its main action is pronation of the forearm. So here we complete muscle number one, and we give the name here as pronator teres. Now second muscle. Second muscle during dissection which we come across will be flexor carpi radialis. We are going in a sequence. We are going from lateral to medial side. So therefore now we come across to flexor carpi radialis. Origin of flexor carpi radialis will be from, once again, from the common origin of flexor group of muscles of forearm. And what is the common origin of flexor group of muscles of forearm? Medial epicondyle. So flexor carpi radialis will take origin from medial epicondyle of the humerus. From there it will pass down in the form of a tendon. It will pass just behind the flexor retinaculum. So flexor retinaculum, if we show the flexor retinaculum at this level, then this flexor retinaculum, we can show it will cover, and these are the front of the carpal bones, and here we show this is the flexor retinaculum. Now the flexor carpi radialis, after taking its origin from the medial epicondyle, it will pass down in the form of a tendon. It will then pass down in the form of a tendon. This is flexor carpi radialis here, and it will pass in the form of a tendon. It will pass deep to flexor retinaculum. So this flexor carpi radialis muscle, it will pass in such a way through the flexor retinaculum that it will perforate the flexor retinaculum. It will perforate the flexor retinaculum, and then it will pass through osteofibrous tunnel. And this osteofibrous tunnel is present where? On trapezium bone. On the trapezium bone. So on the trapezium bone, it will travel through osteofibrous tunnel which is lined by a synovial sheath. So therefore the tendon of flexor carpi radialis will travel, it will perforate the flexor retinaculum, then it will travel through osteofibrous tunnel which is formed by the trapezium bone, that is one of the carpal bone, and through its common, through its synovial sheath. It will have a separate synovial sheath, this tendon. So after passing through the tunnel, it will then be inserted. Where it will be inserted? It will be inserted across the palmar surface. Palmar surface, this is the palmar surface of the base of second and third metacarpal bones. So it will be inserted into the palmar surface. So here if I show it in the dotted form, then this tendon will be inserted into the palmar surface of the base of second and third metacarpal bones. This is the point of insertion of flexor carpi radialis. Please note down. Point of insertion of flexor carpi radialis will be on the palmar surface of the base of second and third metacarpal bones. What will be the nerve supply of flexor carpi radialis? median nerve. And what is the action of flexor carpi radialis? The flexor carpi radialis action will be, it will flex, it will help in flexion of the wrist joint. At the same time, it will help along with extensor carpi radialis longus and brevis, it will help in abduction of the wrist joint, abduction at the level of wrist joint. So here we complete muscle number 2, and this muscle will be flexor carpi radialis. Then we come across, I'll put the numbers 1, then 2. Then we come across palmaris longus. Now this palmaris longus tendon, it will take origin from, once again, medial epicondyle. After taking origin from medial epicondyle, the tendon of palmaris longus will pass like this. And this tendon of palmaris longus muscle will be exactly lying on or superficial to flexor digitorum superficialis muscle. Origin of palmaris longus, from the common origin of all the flexor muscles of the front of forearm, that is medial epicondyle of the humerus. It will travel in such a way that it is lying superficial to flexor digitorum superficialis, and then it will merge with flexor retinaculum. So after merging with flexor retinaculum, the fibers of palmaris longus will continue in the palm as central part of palmar aponeurosis. In the palm there is palmar aponeurosis, so therefore this palmaris longus tendon will merge with the flexor retinaculum insertion. This is the insertion which I am discussing, the insertion of palmaris longus with the flexor retinaculum, and through it, it will then pass as the central fibers of the palmar aponeurosis, that is palmaris longus. Now supply of palmaris longus will be median nerve, and the action will be, it will help in the flexion of the wrist joint. It is a weak flexor of the wrist joint. So therefore here I will name this as palmaris longus muscle, and this is muscle number 3. Then muscle number 4 will be flexor carpi ulnaris. Now this flexor carpi ulnaris it will take its origin again from two heads, just like pronator teres. Pronator teres, we have discussed, it is having two heads, humeral, ulnar. Same flexor carpi ulnaris will have two heads, humeral and ulnar. So humeral head of flexor carpi ulnaris will be from, number 1, it will take its origin from the medial epicondyle of the humerus. And ulnar head will be from medial margin of coronoid process of ulna. Not coronoid, but olecranon process of ulna. Here we have shown coronoid process, so just posterior to it there will be olecranon process of ulna. So medial margin of olecranon process of ulna, and from the posterior border of the ulna, upper two-third of the posterior border of ulna, where there is a common aponeurosis for three muscles. There is a common aponeurosis for three muscles across the posterior border of ulna. What are those three muscles? Flexor carpi ulnaris, extensor carpi ulnaris, and flexor digitorum profundus. So therefore, our origin of flexor carpi ulnaris, now here I am showing the origin of flexor carpi ulnaris, this muscle will take its origin, now here this is the muscle, it will take its origin from medial epicondyle of humerus as humeral head, and the ulnar head will take its origin from medial margin of olecranon process of ulna, and the upper two-third of the posterior border of ulna, which will serve as a common aponeurosis for three muscles. What are those three muscles from common aponeurosis? They are flexor carpi ulnaris, extensor carpi ulnaris, and flexor digitorum profundus. So this is the origin of flexor carpi ulnaris. Humeral head from medial epicondyle, ulnar head from the medial margin of olecranon process of ulna, and upper two-third of the common aponeurosis from posterior border of ulna, humeral and ulnar head. Both the heads will fuse, and the flexor carpi ulnaris will then pass down, and it will pass in such a way that this flexor carpi ulnaris muscle will then be inserted into the PC form bone. It will be passing directly into the PC form bone. It will be passing into the PC form bone. From PC form bone, it will relay in the form of two ligaments, pisohemate and pisometacarpal bone. So from pisohemate, it will then be inserted into the hook of hemate, and from piece of metacarpal ligament, it will be inserted into the base, palmar surface of the base of fifth metacarpal bone. This is the fifth metacarpal bone. So here I have shown these two points of insertion. From through piece of hamate ligament, it will be inserted from pisiform to the hook of hamate. And through piece of metacarpal ligament, it will be inserted from pisiform bone to the base of the fifth metacarpal bone. This is the insertion of flexor carpi ulnaris muscle. This muscle, the tendon of this muscle will be inserted first into pisiform bone, and from pisiform bone it will be relayed through two ligaments, piso-hamate, piso-metacarpal ligament. Through piso-hamate ligament it will be inserted into hook of hamate, and through piso-metacarpal it will be inserted into the base of the fifth metacarpal bone. Now this is asked as MCQ here. And this flexor carpi ulnaris, now the nerve supply, what will be the nerve supply? Ulnar nerve. The flexor carpi ulnaris is supplied by ulnar nerve. And what will be the action? Action of flexor carpi ulnaris will be flexion of the wrist joint, and second action is adduction of the wrist joint. Along with extensor carpi ulnaris, it will help in adduction of the wrist joint. So here we finish flexor carpi ulnaris, the flexor carpi ulnaris, and this will serve as muscle number 4. And then we come to muscle number 5, flexor digitorum superficialis. It is a wonderful muscle. It is having once again two heads of origin. The first head of origin is humero ulnar head, second head of origin is radial head. Once again mark it, humero ulnar head is first head of origin, second head of origin is radial head. The space which is present here will be filled up by the bulk of this muscle. Humero ulnar head of origin of flexor digitorum superficialis. The other name of superficialis is sublimis. So the humero ulnar head of origin will be number 1. It will take origin from medial epicondyle of humerus. It will take origin from the medial epicondyle of the humerus. And from the ulna, where does it take origin? It will take origin from medial margin of the coronoid process of ulna. Medial margin of coronoid process of ulna, proximal to the pronator teres head. Proximal to pronator teres head. So medial margin of coronoid process of ulna. So here, this is the medial margin of coronoid process of ulna, proximal to pronator teres head. So this is functioning as humero ulnar head of origin of flexor digitorum superficialis. Once again I repeat, humero ulnar head of origin of flexor digitorum superficialis, this is one head taking origin from medial epicondyle of humerus as well as medial margin of coronoid process of ulna. Where exactly? Proximal to the pronator teres head. Medial margin of coronoid process of ulna. So this is humero ulnar head. Radial head, the radial head will take origin from anterior oblique line of radius. So it will take origin from this line, anterior oblique line of radius. Now this entire humero ulnar head, the humero ulnar head and radial head, they will join with each other and will form this muscle. So this is the muscle. Now if I use different color, I can show with green color. I will show this muscle with green color. This is the humero ulnar head. This is the radial head. It will join with each other and it will lie deep to palmaris longus. Now these heads will join with together, and the distal part of the forearm, in the distal part of forearm, it will then form four tendons for index finger, middle finger, ring finger and little finger. So deep to palmaris longus, it will be arranged in the form of different tendons, and these tendons will be deep to palmaris longus muscle. Please note down, deep to palmaris longus muscle, these tendons of flexor digitorum superficialis will be arranged. Beneath the flexor retinaculum, and then these tendons will split at the level of the proximal phalanges to be inserted into the middle phalanges. Now I want to show this, so I will draw another diagram to show how is the insertion of flexor digitorum superficialis. Now the insertion of flexor, if we come on this side, the insertion of flexor digitorum superficialis on this side, if I want to show, I will show it as, first of all, if I show this as the scaphoid lunate riquetal pisiform, then I will show here as trapezium, trapezoid, capitate, and Emmet, Book of Emmet, of course. And then I want to show here, these are the metacarpal bones. So I will show here, these are the metacarpal bones. And these metacarpal bones, very fast, 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5. And then the phalanges. So in the phalanges, always mark down here 1 and 2. There will be two phalanges for the thumb pollux. Now there will be, I will show here, three phalanges. These are the three phalanges respectively for index finger, middle ring, and little finger. So very fast we are going to draw these phalanges. These are the three phalanges: proximal phalanx, middle phalanx, and distal phalanx. So you can also draw alongside with me proximal, middle, and distal phalanx. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and two phalanges for the thumb pollux, and proximal, middle, distal phalanges for the remaining fingers. Now the insertion of flexor digitorum superficialis. This flexor digitorum superficialis muscle, as it passes beneath the flexor retinaculum, it will then split into the tendons. This is first tendon, this will be second tendon, third tendon, and fourth tendon. Four tendons for index finger, middle ring, and little finger. After splitting into these four tendons, each tendon will split into two parts across the proximal phalanx. It will split into two parts, and then it will be inserted into the middle phalanges. It will be inserted into the middle phalanges. Middle phalanges of which digits? Index finger, middle finger, ring finger, and little finger. This is how the insertion of flexor digitorum superficialis will take place. So this is how flexor digitorum superficialis will be inserted. Each of the tendons will split across proximal phalanx, and it will be inserted into the middle phalanx of the medial four digits, or middle phalanges of index finger, middle finger, ring, and little finger. This is very important. And through this split portion, there will be the deep tendons passing, which I will explain to you. Now coming back to this point here, this four tendons, if we come on this side, the four tendons, they are present at the level of wrist joint in such a way that beneath the flexor retinaculum, all the four tendons are arranged in such a way that superficial will be palmaris, longest muscle. Beneath it will be the four tendons of flexor digitorum superficialis. And these four tendons of flexor digitorum superficialis will pass beneath the flexor retinaculum. Then the point of insertion we have seen over there. But here, they are arranged once again in two planes, superficial and deep. The tendons for middle finger and ring finger will be superficial, and the tendons for index and little finger will be deep. Please note down. The tendons of flexor digitorum superficialis, it is very well observed in dissection. Beautifully you can see in dissection also, that as the tendons of flexor digitorum superficialis are deep to palmaris longus at the level of wrist joint, they are arranged in two planes. The tendon of the middle and ring finger will be superficial, and the tendons for index and little finger will be deep. This you can very well observe in the dissection. And then they will pass in front of the carpal bones, and they will split into, once again, they will diverge into the four tendons for index, middle, ring, and little fingers, and then the insertion what I have discussed with you. Now this flexor digitorum superficialis, which is muscle number 5, which I can write it as, this muscle I will write it as flexor digitorum superficialis, and this will serve as muscle number 5. Now here, nerve supply of flexor digitorum superficialis will be from the median nerve, and the action of flexor digitorum superficialis will be, it will help in the flexion. If we come back here, please come back here, see the points of insertion. They are inserted across the middle phalanges of index finger, middle ring, and little finger. So they will help in flexion of which phalanges? Middle phalanges. As a result of which, there will be flexion at which joint? This joint. And this joint is proximal interphalangeal joint. The joint between the proximal and middle phalanx is proximal interphalangeal joint. So therefore, the action of flexor digitorum superficialis will be flexion of middle phalanges of index, middle, ring, and little finger, and flexion of the proximal interphalangeal joints. That is flexion of the proximal interphalangeal joints of the index, middle ring and little finger. So here, please come on this side. We have completed the five superficial muscles of the front of forearm, which are very important. Origin, insertion, action and nerve supply we have discussed. Pronator teres, then we have discussed flexor carpi radialis. We are going in a sequence. In this section also, you will observe this in a sequence. Pronator teres first, second flexor carpi radialis, third palmaris longus, fourth flexor carpi ulnaris on the ulnar border, and the fifth is which is lying deep to palmaris longus, that is flexor digitorum superficialis. So here we finish the superficial group of muscles of the front of forearm. Thank you very much. Coming up in the next segment is deep group of muscles.